Hello and welcome to QCon Plus. My name is Katharina Probst and I'm an engineering director at Google. I am here to talk to you about complex systems, microservices, and humans. Let's start with a question that might come as a little bit of a surprise. What do polar bears have to do with microservices? At first glance, you might say they probably don't have a whole lot to do with each other. But let's dig a little bit deeper. As you may know, polar bears eat seals. And so it's reasonably easy to understand that the population of polar bears has a strong relationship with the population of seals. But if you go one step further or a few steps further, then it gets much more complicated much more quickly. So let's do that. As the climate changes, the habitat of polar bears and seals is changing as well. What the impact of the changing habitat is on the population of seals and in turn polar bears is actually much more tricky to predict. And what about other animals on the food chain, such as penguins or krill? Reasonably quickly, you get yourself to a point where you have an ecosystem that is difficult to really, really get our heads around. And I would make a case that in some ways, microservices architectures behave similarly. Now, we rarely have one service actually eating another service, but we do have those complex relationships. So let's dive into that a little bit. If you've gone down the microservices journey, you have perhaps started with an architecture diagram that looks a little bit like the one we have here on the left. You have thought about your business logic, what you're trying to accomplish, what your system has to do, and you've drawn an architecture diagram that neatly spells out where everything sits, how it behaves, and what the relationship is between those services that you're going to create. But as time goes on, quite quickly, things get more complicated. Maybe you spin up new teams, you have a business reason to have new functionality, or maybe you realize that one of your services still encompasses too much behavior and you want to break that out. And then, of course, you want to add databases, you want to add caches, and so forth. So quite quickly, you get to a point where it's much more difficult to see all the relationships and even write down all the relationships between all the services that you have in your architecture. Now, that is the theory, actually. In reality, when you talk to companies that have very complex systems, their system looks a little bit more like the one on the right. Very complex architectures where many companies have hundreds or even thousands of services, and they all interact with each other. Maybe not all of them interact with each other directly, but there is strong relationships between many, many of them. And so by the time you get to something like the picture on the right, it's actually very difficult to just write down the architecture and write down everything that goes on in the system. Now, I want to emphasize that that doesn't mean, from my perspective, that a monolith is the right answer here and that microservices in and of themselves make life hard. That's not my perspective. My perspective is that if you have as much functionality as you have here that requires hundreds or thousands of services, if you put all of that in one monolith, you'd have many other problems. And it would not necessarily be any easier to reason about. So from my perspective, there are cases where monoliths are the right architecture. And there are many cases also where microservices are the right architecture. And the fact that microservices and complex microservices systems are difficult to reason about is something that I feel like we should embrace. And the industry is in fact embracing and building lots of tools to help us understand this, these systems. And I will get into that in a little bit more detail. Now, when you build your microservices architecture, there are certain best practices that many of us follow. So for instance, what you're seeing here on the left is a hint at how this architecture might align to teams. So some teams may own more than one microservice. The anti-pattern that we're really trying to avoid is that many, many teams own one service together. And so having a clean separation of these responsibilities really helps in breaking down functionality in a way that teams individually can reason about portions of their system. And then not only reason about it, but also evolve their portions of the system. But there is one aspect to this that I think is worth talking about. And that is that we actually already have an organization of people. We work in organizations that are in general, organized into teams, right? So you see a theoretical org chart here on the left. This might look like something that you might see in your own companies. And so we have these org charts and these organizations of teams, but then that org chart doesn't map very neatly onto the microservices architecture necessarily, right? And maybe it shouldn't. And the interrelationships between these teams are actually more subtle and often more complicated than what you see in the org chart. And that is because if you have microservices and you have dependencies between these microservices and interactions between them, then the teams owning them by necessity sometimes need to interact with each other. Microservices are constructed in a way that gives as much independence as possible and as much autonomy as possible to the individual teams. But what we also understand is that the microservices can still impact each other. And so therefore, having these strong ties between these teams is still beneficial. So what I would say is that we have actually two levels of complex systems. We have our microservices, and then we have our human organization, our human system overlay, or you could call it an underpinning of the microservices system. It doesn't matter. But the point is that there are actually two systems, and they're both complex, and they both interact with each other in interesting ways that I think we need to talk about and study more deeply. So when we talk about taming the complexity of these systems, my mental model is that, you know, this falls into three rough buckets. This is not the only way you can categorize this, but this helps me kind of get my head around the kinds of things that I need to be thinking about when I talk about trying to understand the system better and trying to create a system and keep a system that is healthy and can operate well. So my mental model falls into these three buckets. The first bucket is configuration and setup. This is really where you think about, what does my architecture look like? What are the fundamental design choices that I make? For instance, do I create service meshes, or even do I create microservices or not? What are kind of the best practices that I want to follow? So then you create your system, and then you have a system, and that system needs to change on an ongoing basis. We've talked about, you know, adding new services, but there's also many changes that happen within existing services, right? You need to evolve your business logic, add new functionality, and so forth. So there's a lot of work that goes on in this area that talks about how can we quickly and safely deliver new code to production. So CI/CD, GitOps, what are best practices around testing and slowly rolling out changes. And then the third bucket is what many call day two operations. And what that means is code that is running in production, your customers are interacting with that code, and you want to make sure that whatever is running in production keeps running and keeps running well for your customers. And so there's a body of work going on that I would roughly characterize as falling into that bucket, such as load testing, understanding what kind of load your systems can hold, monitoring, you know, very, very fundamental things such as logs, monitor, testing, things, chaos testing, and things like that. So again, this is my mental model, and the boundaries are somewhat blurry. And obviously some of these tools that we have, like Kubernetes, can help you not only with the configuration and setup, but also with rolling out changes. And, you know, load testing is not only about testing a system that's already running in production, it's also about helping you make safe changes. But roughly, I find it useful because it helps us understand, or it helps me understand, what are the kinds of things that I need to be paying attention to. And in each of these buckets, what are the tools that I employ to help me get that fundamental understanding? So when we talk about systems and keeping systems healthy, we often talk about incidents, right? And this is an important component, but I want to emphasize that having healthy systems is not only about preventing incidents, it's also about making sure that we can evolve our systems at a reasonable velocity so that we can add features fast, that they don't take years to add, for instance, and you know that we have a system that actually is observable and well-tested and well-maintainable. But incidents are an important part of having a healthy system, right? Because we want our customers to experience a very reliable system that they can interact with in a fashion that suits their own business needs, perhaps. So let's talk a little bit about incidents. Almost by definition, if you're doing it right, incidents or outages are surprising. Why? Because many of us do postmortems or reflections after something happens, or incident reviews after an incident happens. And the whole goal of these incident reviews is to ensure that the same kind of incident doesn't happen again. So if you're doing that right, then almost by definition, an outage will be surprising to you. And I think that's okay. Right, I think it's okay to embrace that and to say, yes, we're constantly improving and we will still run into trouble sometimes, because we need to deliver the system that no one person can maybe reason about. So just embracing that, I think, is a good step. And helps us put us in a mindset where we constantly improve the health of our system and our understanding of the system. So when incidents happen, for instance, they can be to parts of the system that are really far away from each other, where it's actually difficult to see how did this happen. You know, so you know, you might take an example, like you have the service here on the left. Let's say that's a recommender system, and let's say you've rolled out a new algorithm that helps you recommend better whatever you're trying to recommend in your business. And then you have the system up here on the top right, and let's say that is your billing system. So obviously your billing system is really critical to your business, because that's how customers pay you. And it can happen that, you know, a system such as the recommender system here on the left has a bad negative impact on the billing system. And you may sit there and wonder, why did this happen? This should never have happened. That's right, it never should have. Maybe one answer is, maybe you have a hidden dependency. Oftentimes in complex microservices systems, you have these dependencies that you may not even realize you have, or maybe you didn't realize you have them to the extent that you have them. And so, you know, again, going back to my three buckets on the previous slide, this is something that perhaps service meshes can really help you understand where those dependencies are and how strong they are. And another important point about incidents is that they can actually happen days or months after the code is rolled out. And the thing about this is that it can hit at any point in time. And no matter when it happens, it feels like it's an inconvenient time. So, you know, we have Alice here as an example on the bottom right. So maybe she's on call for one of those systems. Maybe she's on call for the billing system. And everything has been going fine, but this new algorithm, this new recommender algorithm has had a negative impact after a while on this hidden dependency, which is now impacting her system. Maybe Alice has just put in a full day's worth of work and she is really tired and is just about to go home, and then an alert fires. And that really leads us to a discussion about how do human systems actually impact the health of our microservices systems as well. So let's dive into that a little bit. When you talk about human systems, my mental model is actually not that different from my mental model about microservices system. In that, I still believe we have these three buckets, these three rough buckets that help me reason through what kind of things I need to be thinking about and need to be paying attention to. So in the first bucket, we have configuration and setup. So this is where organizations spend a lot of time thinking about job ladders, about the culture of an organization, how to motivate people, how to set expectations of specific roles. And also this is where diversity, equity, and inclusion plays a huge role. So really creating an organization that is high functioning is the focus of this bucket. And then the second bucket is the acknowledgement that organizations change on an ongoing basis. So on the positive side, we have people that get promoted and then they take on perhaps more scope. And that's great. And it's wonderful to help people, to see people progress in their careers, but it is a change to the system, to the organization that we have. And it may mean that, maybe this person now takes on additional responsibility, and so they're not paying attention as much anymore to one part of the system that they were paying attention to before. And maybe that leaves a gap. Similarly, we have new people coming on board. Obviously, we need to train them. We have people leaving the team. Sometimes regrettably, sometimes not, but either way, these are big changes to the system as well. And then of course, org changes when maybe you move entire organizations around and need to really ensure that the new organization functions well and that the teams interact with each other well. So that's changes that are essentially driven by the organization itself. But then there's also this class of things that I would call day two operations, just to draw the parallel to what we had before. And that's what I think of as external forces and sort of broader culture changes. So external forces are a big thing that, one very obvious example is COVID, that all of our organizations have gone through, couldn't have possibly planned for, in a comprehensive way, and we need to deal and make the best of it as an organization. So there's a lot of work that we need to do to ensure that our organizations are still healthy despite all the pressures that are put on our organizations and our people because of these external forces such as COVID. And then positive culture changes are the kinds of changes that we make, again, perhaps, ensuring that everybody who works there feels included and can show up and bring their best work to work. So if you think about these three buckets and you spend a little bit of time thinking back to the incident that we were just touching on, where Alice is on call, she's on call for the billing system and it's failing. What do these three buckets have to do with how this incident plays out? And I would make the case that actually they have a lot to do with it. So Alice is now going through this roller coaster of emotions. She's maybe frustrated, she's scared, she's frustrated that her dinner plans are ruined. And now what comes into play here is the entire culture, the underpinning culture of the organization. So for instance, has she gotten the right amount of training from her peers? That's a clear one. But then also, let's say she figures out that she needs to contact somebody. Does she feel comfortable doing that? Does she have the right tools that she needs in order to know whom to contact? So oftentimes incidents require experts from all over. So, you know, going back to our incident example here, Alice is here on the right, she's responsible for the billing system. And we have Ethan here on the left, who's responsible for the recommender system. And I'm sure there are more people, such as whoever is responsible for this dependency that had a problem because of the change to the recommender system. Now let's think about the interrelationship. Does Alice even know Ethan? Does she know? Does she again feel comfortable reaching out to him? Do they work together? Do they have the right incentives to work together to solve this problem, or are they incentivized to just, you know, throw the problem over the wall and let somebody else handle it because they're afraid of what it might mean for their careers, for instance? So all of these cultural things play a huge role in how this incident plays out. And again, I want to emphasize that this is not only about incidents. You can make the same kind of argument for the health of the organization impacting how quickly you can deliver features, how maintainable your code is, and so forth. And so it from my perspective, it's really on us to do what we can to build healthy organizations, which are not only healthy for the people that are in them, which is really, really critical, but they actually also have an impact on the bottom line. So the main takeaway here is, I believe there is a complex interaction between two complex systems. We often talk about there not being a single root cause to anything that happens, but many contributing factors. And again, this could be an incident, it could be a delayed feature launch or something like this. Maybe there's not one root cause, but several contributing factors, such as, you know, maybe one person has imposter syndrome, maybe one person won't admit that they don't know something. Maybe we don't have the right alerts and metrics in place. So all of these things interact with each other to create the outcome that we may or may not like. So when we talk about human systems, I would posit there is a lot of prior art, and that from my perspective, we need to bring a lot of that prior art to our organizations and use it to do what we can to build healthy organizations. So I give you some examples here, but this slide is really meant to get you to think about what are the kinds of areas that might help me understand my organization better. Obviously, there is a lot of research in organizational psychology, but there are other areas too that dive into specific aspects. So for instance, human factor studies the interactions between human error and environment. So you might think about, what am I doing to make it easy for people to roll changes out slowly? You know, what systems do I have in place? Again, this might be one of the systems that we've mentioned before, like Kubernetes or service meshes. There's CI/CD tools that are really helpful in helping automate a lot of these steps, rather than forcing people to do things manually in many, many steps, which they may then not do, right? And then that is actually related to the kinds of things that I'm interested in studying in behavioral economics, which have to do, for instance, with incentives. You know, are we setting up the right incentives in our environment and in our organizations? Are we making sure that people are incentivized to ask for help, that they're incentivized to collaborate with other teams? Or are we actually creating barriers for doing that, or subtly nudging them away? And that's the other example I gave here, nudging them away from asking other people. Maybe they have seen examples of where their performance evaluation was hurt because they asked somebody a question and that person didn't react well. We need to make sure that our organizations are set up in a way that sets us up for success here. And then the final bullet point I have here is about motivation. You've heard this in perhaps in other talks before, but it's really thinking through, are people actually able to bring their best work? Are they motivated to do so? Are they motivated by mastery, that they're learning new things? Do they have the right autonomy? And do they understand how their work fits into the broader picture and why that matters, right? And it's also important to point out that different people are motivated by different things, or maybe a different combination of these things. And so really understanding our organization and not just driving one thing, I think is also super helpful. Again, these are just examples of things that I think, or areas that I think we can learn from. But I think actually embracing that there is so much work out there and so much prior art that can help us really understand how to make our human systems better and also our microservices systems better, I think is an important step. So what do we do with all of this? I think one of the main things I would like for you to take away is that from my perspective, microservices systems, yes, they can be super complex. If you have hundreds or thousands of microservices, they can be very difficult to reason about. However, there is it's not the right choice is not to say, oh, you know, they're too complicated and I won't go down that route. From my perspective, in many cases, they're still the right choice. And then the right approach is to embrace, yes, they're complicated. Now, what do we do about it? And this is where I come back to, you know, the industry has actually spent a lot of time and a lot of effort in creating all kinds of tools and approaches to help us understand and improve our systems. So I list some of them here. There's many more. But the one thing I would say is that it's actually really important to be clear what you're doing with those tools. So what I would advise against is adopting one of these tools just because everybody else is adopting it. And you'll say, oh, I'll adopt it, and then I guess I'll figure out how it's useful or why I need it. Instead, be very clear about what you're trying to accomplish. Maybe the mental model that I presented of, you know, configuration changes and day two operations can be useful in helping to figure out what kinds of things you need to understand about your system and what kinds of things you need to have in place in order to automate your system more and improve it and make it stable. But being very clear about the goals, I think, is critical here. And then when it comes to human systems, I feel like oftentimes we talk, you know, we talk a lot about game days and education forums and design reviews and on-call training. I think these are wonderful and super, super important. But I don't think they go quite enough. I think we need to actually go one level deeper. And this is what I was getting at when I was talking about the culture and inclusion and the kinds of collaboration incentives we set up and so forth. Because I think if you have a poorly functioning organization that has poor incentives, then all the game days in the world aren't gonna make you, aren't gonna put you in a good position. All the on-call training in the world will not put you in a position where whoever is on call will then feel comfortable reaching out if that's what your organization incentivizes against. So my perspective is that we really need to go one level deeper and think very deeply about the kinds of job ladders that we set up, the kind of organization that we build, and how our people function within it, and how we build, you know, how we can continuously improve organizational health. And organizational health, from where I'm sitting, is really, really critical in and of itself. And it's really important to make people feel like they can show up for work, they have a career path, they feel happy about it. But even if you're not motivated by that, I think there's a pretty clear case to be made that organizational health has a real impact on business health. And with that, I will open it up for questions. I also put up here my LinkedIn profile where you can find me. Thank you very much.
Hello, everyone, and many thanks to Katharina for that great keynote. Lots of great ideas there, recommendations to explore. We've got approximately 15 minutes for live Q&A now. So if you'd like to ask any questions, please do via the chat box or on Slack as well. And I'll try and keep an eye on those. I'll just wait for Katharina to join me. I see a couple of folks asking questions. Feel free to put the questions directly into the chat box. I'll try and keep an eye on that and pass them on to Katharina. And Slack is also a good way of doing that too. Thank you so much for the keynote. Awesome stuff. As I said in the intro, I always learn lots from you when we sit down and we chat. I love the blending of technology, people, and organization, because like all of those things coming together are really important, right?
For sure. Yes.
Awesome. Awesome. We have some great questions coming in, Katharina. I see you've already answered one of them, but I wanted to put it on camera for folks. It's Fabio. Thanks, Fabio, for your question. In an organization where the team's relationships are driven by tickets and bureaucracy, can you suggest some quick wins to make these relationships run more smoothly?
I think it's a great question. And I think it really depends on the organization, obviously. I have seen organizations and spoken with people that work in organizations where everything is kind of done through tickets and everything is measured by how quickly tickets are resolved. And that's how people are incentivized. So in some sense, I don't know that there are quick wins that will solve the whole problem. But I think when I see organizations and they need to kind of or they have the desire to make a major shift, then it probably takes a while and it takes a lot of nudges to nudge the organization into a different direction. That being said, I think in my experience, when it kind of deteriorates into a situation where people are just kind of communicating over tickets and over kind of incidents, then getting them in a room together or a virtual room and just, you know, getting to know each other can really help, I think. And somebody also posted smiling might help. So I think
that's great, wasn't it?
That's a good point as well, yes.
So. Brilliant. Sort of following on from that, Katharina, it says Dharmesh, you spoke about having teams developers owning microservices. Wouldn't this create additional silos? And if so, how can you manage or avoid that?
So I'm not exactly sure how I would create additional silos. So in my experience, one thing that is a little bit of an anti-pattern is if you have one group of people who writes the code and another group of people who knows nothing that maybe about the code, but it has to pick up the call when something goes wrong at 3 a.m. Mm-hmm. And that in and of itself is maybe not a silo in theory, but in practice, it creates a gap between those two teams, right? So basically consolidating that in a team where the team not only writes the code and pushes out the changes, maybe together with another team, but also, you know, is at least partially on the hook for the team for the system when something goes wrong, I think it creates that sense of I drive it, I own it, and I'm on the hook for it, and it's mine. So that can actually be really helpful, I think.
I like that a lot. I've seen the Netflix folks talk about full life cycle, sort of full life cycle ownership of things, which is super interesting.
Yeah. And there can certainly also be room, you know, for a separate team, like an SRE team or something like that also is part of that entire process, right? But kind of making it as much as possible so that those teams own it together, I think is really helpful.
Awesome stuff, Katharina. Awesome stuff. Another question from CTV. I'm architecting microservices, but have about 10 services and already see lots of integration issues. How do you manage the chaos in these services? Great question.
Buckle your seatbelt. yeah. So I think that's exactly right. You know, it gets pretty complicated pretty quickly. And so I think that's why there is so much investment in observability and this tooling so that we can get our heads around that, right? And I think, you know, obviously we need lots of tooling and instrumentation to understand as much as we can about the system. And, you know, that goes also into, you know, distributed tracing and you know, understanding how systems kind of can impact each other and so forth. So I think my advice would be don't necessarily shy away from that, but invest in doing the best you can to understand the behavior of your system.
Brilliant. Maybe moving back to more the people side now, a couple of questions in the chat about incentives. So I see Noel and some other folks, Kashmir. Can you give examples of incentives that have worked in organizations you've been part of in the past?
Yeah, so I think, you know, when you talk about incentives, people often first start talking about money, and of course that is one incentive, right? Let's be honest. But I think it's a little bit deeper, right? Incentives, I think from my perspective, incentives work best when they're set up in a way that you know, that create the right behavior and actually allow people to be happy and grow their careers. So let me give you an example. So for instance, if it's important for you and your organization that you drive ownership, okay, so let's go back to this example where maybe developers also need to pick up the phone at 3 a.m. if something goes wrong, right? Maybe in some organizations, they don't get any reward for that, right? That means you don't have the incentive set up in a way that people are rewarded. Now, if you just you know, even in performance reviews or, you know, with peer, you know, reinforcement or with enforcement from the leadership, you actually reward that, then the incentive is different. It's set up in a different way, right? So that's the kind of incentive I'm talking about. Like, for instance, if you need an organization where teams work together well, how do you incentivize that, right? You incentivize that perhaps by not just creating meetings, but then also rewarding those people that actually drive, you know, drive that collaboration.
I like it a lot. Some folks have asked about, could you recommend any books for facing the human challenges? I know you put a few, like Dan Pink's classic book is that up there, but any other books at all?
I have so many that I like. So I'm rereading Nudge right now.
Malcolm Gladwell, is that thinking?
Yes, no, it's this one.
Oh, that one. Oh, nice.
Yeah. So this is a really great book about how you can, this is actually, it's not fully about business, but it does talk about, you know, how you can create small incentives and small nudges so to kind of like slowly change behavior. And I really like that because I think when you have a large organization or a large change that you're trying to accomplish, and you know, oftentimes the best course of action is just like slowly move it in one direction, right? So you may have heard, you know, this is not about business, but one concrete example is like, you know, if you if you're trying not to eat so much candy and you leave the candy in the kitchen rather than on your desk, you will eat less candy. That is a nudge, right? So you can apply that to many, many different situations.
Brilliant. Love that recommendation. I've read the book. It's a fantastic book. Awesome.
I love it. Yeah.
Moving into technology again. So I'm trying to sort of flip between the two in some ways. A couple of folks have asked, Prakash, one of them, how best to assess a microservice system? Say you're a technical leader, you've arrived at an organization, you've bought into the vision, and you want to get a handle on where the technical aspects are and where the people aspects are as well. Any advice there, Katharine?
Yeah, I think, you know, if you're completely new to the system, some of the first things I would be looking at is, does your team understand all of their upstream and downstream dependencies? You know, that's not always understood. Does your team understand the limits of their system? That's also not always well understood. You know, like how many, you know, what if you can't talk to all of these downstream services? What will happen to your system? Do you have metrics and dashboards and things set up? That's another one. Nice. And then the other thing I would look at is velocity, right? So how quickly can you actually make changes and land those changes safely in production? Because once, you know, sometimes the more kind of barnacles you grow in your system, the slower things get, right? So I think that's another really important aspect to look at.
Very nice. On that note, how would you measure organizational health?
Yeah, that's a really great question too. And you know, people, you know, we talk about microservices systems being complicated. I think Humans are endlessly fascinating, and organizations of humans are perhaps even more so. So when it comes to metrics or assessing health of organization, there are so many things, right? So there are some of the more obvious things are like, well, what is your retention? You know, do people leave all the time? And quit in frustration, right? That's an obvious sign that something is going wrong. But I think when you're also looking at how productive is your organization, right? There's a lot of proxy metrics and people find a lot of faults with them, and I get why, right? Like proxy metrics such as how much code is submitted or how quickly do we turn around code reviews and things like that. Those are all proxy metrics, but they can tell you something and they can tell you trends. So that's one thing. And then the other thing, honestly, I find is you just need to talk to people because everybody kind of has a different perspective. And all the proxy metrics in the world aren't going to get you at the one level deeper of what people are struggling with, what people are happy about. Right? So.
Superb, Gavin, superb. I think we're getting close to time now. So I'll thank you once again. It's been a fantastic exploration into a very complex topic. Really appreciate all the references you put in your slides. I'm sure you might be around on the Slack, or we can connect folks to you if they want some more recommendations. I know you always got fantastic recommendations, which is brilliant. Thank you once again. The day's talks will begin in 10 minutes time. So now is the time to grab your beverage of choice. Visit the schedule page, and check out the track host intros, pick your track you want to go along to, pick the talk you want to go along to, and we'll see you there. Thanks again, everyone.
Thank you.
Thanks, everyone.